Hi everyone, I'm Dmitri, and today we will be talking with Marcel about how to adopt Rust in large code bases. So, you want to use Rust. The usual advice is to rewrite your current project in Rust. Let's see what your current project is like. It is probably deployed in production. It depends on libraries that are not available in Rust. The project has a lot of code, possibly millions of lines. Your team is pretty large, maybe 50 or even 100 people. And the code is written in unsafe languages like C or C++. Is it still a good idea to rewrite it in Rust? In a big project, big changes are done incrementally, one step at a time. If your project is essential for your company's business, you cannot just ask everyone to freeze feature development while you convert a few million lines of code to Rust. You generally should not do a big bang rewrite in Rust unless you have already decided to start from scratch for other reasons. Most likely, a rewrite is not economically and socially viable. So a big project can adopt a new language only through gradual, incremental changes. How could you start adopting Rust in such a project? Let's discuss your strategy. To start, think about where you're going to add Rust code and how it will talk to the rest of the system. It is probably easier to choose a new feature that is not extremely important and that is not central to the project. And it should also not have a hard deadline. Nevertheless, adding Rust code is only one technical aspect of the strategy. Adding Rust to your code base will have an impact on your development process. You want it to be a positive impact, but there can be unexpected negative consequences too. An issue in the edit, compile, test, merge cycle can drain a lot of productivity from a large team. Some people on the team or your leadership might even attribute these workflow issues to the Rust language itself, creating a threat of rolling back the Rust experiment and even banning Rust language altogether. Therefore, you should evaluate your current development process and plan how Rust will fit in. First, writing code. What editors does your team use? Do these editors have plugins for Rust code navigation and code completion? You should be ready to help your coworkers install and troubleshoot these plugins. If you ask your team to figure it out on their own, don't be surprised if in 2 weeks your coworkers are frustrated. I'm sick of it, not even code completion works well in this language. You don't want that. Next, code review. You could just do regular code review, or you could customize the process to the Rust language itself to make the most of your code review. Can you integrate the clip linter in your code review tool as a pre-merge check? Do you want to introduce a special code review process for unsafe Rust code? Does your team have enough people with Rust expertise to mentor engineers who are just starting to learn Rust? Once the code is written, we need build and test tooling. Does your build system support Rust at all? How do Rust unit tests fit into the testing workflow? Can your engineers run Rust and non-Rust tests with just one command? And how about your production deployment canarying and monitoring tools? Do they support Rust binaries? Can they collect monitoring information from Rust code? You should work through all of these questions before adding the first line of Rust code to your shipping product. And finally, introducing a new programming language to a team has a huge social component. What you can do to support your team through these major changes to the development and operational process. For example, you can consider what processes and playbooks you can build to reassure your team that Rust code will not cause extra stress, that Rust will not be the root cause of missed deadlines, and that insufficient Rust expertise on the team will not make outages last longer. I recommend that you prepare a rollback plan. I hope that you will not need it. However, having a rollback plan ready reduces the stress and fear of uncertainty in the team. It also emphasizes that your goal is not to make your team write Rust. Wait, what? The goal is not to switch to Rust? That's right. The goal is to achieve better business outcomes for the company. For example, reduce maintenance costs, improve reliability, or create a better working environment for the team. You should be open to the idea that Rust might not work out for the project, at least with your initial attempt. You could explicitly approach Rust adoption as an experiment. This experiment might or might not succeed. You would remove the need to have universal agreement about Rust at the beginning. At some future point, you will have concrete experience, data, and feedback from the team about your experimental Rust usage. Discussing this data is more productive than debating pros and cons of Rust before starting to use it. You can collect this information, write a report, and hold a retrospective with the team and leadership about whether you want to continue using Rust, and if so, how. Be open to the idea that your initial attempt didn't work well. Take a break and try again. Above all, do what is right for your team. During the Rust adoption experiment, you could limit the process changes to a sub-team, say 5 to 7 people. In our Rust pilots, we found that 2 experienced Rust engineers have enough bandwidth to coach a 5 to 7 people team. If you do start with a sub-team, make sure that you have both senior and junior people on the team, as well as people with and without Rust experience. You will get much better data this way. And this data will be more convincing than any blog post or YouTube video, because data will be about your team, about your project. Now let's discuss technical aspects in detail. When you start adding Rust code to the project, you will need to decide how it will fit into the architecture of the application. You have an important choice: whether Rust code will live in the binary, or if you will add Rust to an existing binary that is written in a different language. This choice will determine how your new Rust code will interact with the rest of the project. In case of a new binary, it will be a cross-process interaction, and you will not have to worry about FFI. If you choose to add Rust to an existing binary, though, you will need to call Rust from another language or vice versa. Let's talk about the first option in more detail. I believe that adding a new Rust binary generally leads to a simpler system. If you choose to go this way, you should find components in your system architecture that already expose a cross-process interface of some sort. For example, it can be a database server, structured data files on disk, or local IPC such as Unix sockets. Finally, your system might already expose an RPC server. Such interfaces are often natural extension points. It is very likely that there is an off-the-shelf Rust crate that allows you to talk to your database server, read and write your favorite file format, or send and receive RPCs through pretty much any protocol. You can start implementing a new binary in Rust that uses these interfaces without disrupting the rest of the system. If you later decide that Rust did not work out for you, you can re-implement this binary in your current programming language. If you can afford it, you can even implement 2 versions of the same binary, one in Rust and one in your current programming language, and compare them. This approach ties in well with framing Rust adoption as an experiment. Let's look at an example. Say we have an application that uses a database. The database is accessed by a backend server. This backend service exposes an internal gRPC endpoint. An HTTP frontend service receives requests from web clients and uses the gRPC backend endpoint. We also have a separate frontend service for our mobile applications. This frontend speaks a REST protocol and uses the same backend. Note that this application does not use a microservice architecture. Each of these 3 services implements a lot of functionality. That's fine, we can work with this. Let's say we want to add a new feature. We want to start sending email notifications to our users. Can we do it in Rust? If the internal gRPC endpoint allows us to fetch information about users and their notifications, we could write a new service in Rust and connect it to the existing backend. The other alternative is to write a new service that talks directly to the database. Now, what if your application has a monolithic architecture? Something like this. Since the database is accessible here, we could use it directly from Rust. But there is another option. We can add an internal gRPC endpoint to our monolithic service. After all, it already exposes HTTP and REST services. Adding another RPC interface shouldn't be a big deal. Now the notification service written in Rust can use the backend functionality through the new RPC endpoint. Your application architecture does not have to be based on client-server type RPCs. For example, if you have a loosely coupled architecture organized around a message bus, a Rust service will fit right in. If you have a data processing pipeline that stores intermediate results in files, you can write a new processing stage in Rust. Now let's talk about adding Rust code to an existing binary. In this case, Rust code will talk to your existing code through an in-process foreign function interface, or FFI for short. Let's say that your existing application is written mostly in C++. You should find an interface boundary in your application where it will be convenient for C++ to interact with Rust. What does this mean? API on this cross-language boundary should be compatible with Rust aliasing and borrow checking rules. I will talk more about this later. Another factor to consider is that bridging small and stable APIs to Rust is easier and cheaper to maintain compared to bridging broad and constantly changing APIs. So I said that foreign language API should follow Rust rules. What do I mean exactly? It is possible to bridge any foreign language API to unsafe Rust. However, that forces your team to sprinkle snippets of unsafe Rust throughout the codebase. This is extremely not desirable. Unsafe Rust can be even more tricky to write than C++ because it has new kinds of undefined behavior compared to C++, for example, stack borrowed violations. Your actual goal should be bringing your foreign language API to safe Rust, and that requires your existing code, for example, your C++ code, to follow Rust safety rules, at least on the API boundary. Let's look at an example. Imagine that one of the central data structures in your application is an in-memory cache. It is used everywhere, so to start writing meaningful logic in Rust, you need to make this cache available to Rust code. Here is the C API for the cache. There is a struct for the cache itself, a struct for the cache entry, and a function to find an entry by its key. You can bridge this simple API to unsafe Rust like this. C structs become Rust structs, a C function becomes an extern C function in Rust, const pointers in C map to const pointers in Rust, and non-const pointers map to mute pointers in Rust. This is a very straightforward mapping. Here's how one can use this bridged API from Rust. Note the unsafe keyword, which is necessary to call an unsafe function, and to dereference a pointer. Writing unsafe Rust code is tricky and error-prone, so unsafe bindings are not a good choice. What we actually want is a safe find entry function. Its parameters and return value use Rust references instead of pointers. One thing to note is that pointers are nullable in Rust, but references are not. So from the documentation, we know that the argument, the cache, must be non-null, so it becomes a plain reference. However, the return value may be null, so it becomes an optional reference. We can call the find entry function without unsafe. This looks great, and we can start writing our application logic in Rust. The only issue is that when key 1 is equal to key 2, we create two mutable references to the same cache entry. This is instant undefined behavior in Rust. Note that the equivalent C code would be perfectly fine and free of undefined behavior. Can we fix our safe Rust bindings to avoid triggering undefined behavior? Yes, we can. The fix is to change the find entry function to borrow the cache mutably. The code that triggers undefined behavior does not compile anymore because it tries to borrow mutably the cache twice. Problem solved. Or is it really? The equivalent code in C would have compiled just fine. We now have safe Rust bindings for the cache API, but they are less expressive than the original C API. If you only ever need to operate on one cache entry at a time, reduced expressivity is not a problem. But what if you actually need to process two distinct cache entries at the same time? It is possible to allow that, but not with this cache entry API. We would need to write a small adapter API that finds two entries at the same time while checking that keys are distinct. But let's not get too much into the details of that. My point is, bridging other languages to safe Rust is tricky. It is very easy to bridge incorrectly, violate Rust aliasing and stack borrows rules, and invoke undefined behavior. But even once you have correctly implemented safe Rust bindings, you might find that you cannot translate your old code into Rust directly because it does not pass the borrow checker. Working around that typically requires redesigning or wrapping your foreign language API, and that might be more work than you anticipated. And now, handing it off to Marcel to talk about the build system.
Thank you, Dmitri. Hello, everybody. My name is Marcel. I work as a software engineer at Google, and I work with Dmitri. As he said, you will need to evaluate your current development process and plan how Rust will fit in. Let's talk about your build system. There is a chance that your project uses a build system that does not support Rust. In that case, you will need to take care of that first, and there are two options. Your first option is to add a second build system to your project, for example, Cargo. This second build system will be responsible only for Rust code. Your current build system will then invoke the inner Rust build system as a build task. The second incremental way forward is to implement Rust support for your current build system. Finally, there is an option to migrate your large project to a different build system. However, this is a huge task and it will need to be done incrementally. The strategy for adopting Rust that Dmitri mentioned before works quite well there too. If you were starting a new Rust-only project, you would probably choose Cargo as the build system, and it would be a nice, smooth experience. Cargo is the default build system and a package manager for Rust, and it's one of the reasons why writing Rust feels so productive. There are other build systems that support Rust, for example, Bazel, Bug, Gradle, and some others. Besides building your production code, a build system is also typically responsible for building and running tests. You can, of course, run Rust and non-Rust tests as two separate tasks in your CI, but it will be inconvenient for engineers to run tests on their local workstation. It is better if your build system can run all tests with a single command. If you choose to adopt a second build system, your top-level build system can ask the inner build system to run Rust tests. Then the top-level build system parses and passes through the pass-fail results. The most integrated solution is to use the Rust build system to build Rust tests and to use the outer build system to run them. One important advantage of Rust is crates.io, a large collection of high-quality open-source libraries. You don't want to miss out on those. They make the cost of adopting Rust lower by providing alternatives to libraries that you may be using written in other languages. Unsurprisingly, Cargo nicely integrates with crates.io. Integrations with other build systems used to be a bit rough, but they are quite decent now and are getting better. If your build system doesn't support Rust, you will need to vendor the crates into your project repository and maintain build scripts for them. Don't forget to include this into your maintenance cost calculation. For some projects, it will make sense to develop automation that generates build scripts from Cargo build files. If you decide to implement support for Rust in your existing build system, one of the first decisions you'll have to make is what kind of output you would request from the Rust compiler. Rust compiler officially supports three build artifacts. Bin is for executable binaries, and it is going to be your choice for out-of-process integration that Dmitri explained before. For in-process integration, you have two supported options and one unsupported. Each of them has its own advantages and limitations. Staticlib is a library artifact that bundles all the Rust code and its dependencies. A limitation of staticlib is that you can only have one staticlib in a binary. Therefore, it must contain all the Rust code that the binary links, and that might be inconvenient from the architectural or the build system point of view. CDILIB is a shared library equivalent of staticlib. Like staticlib, it must contain all the Rust code in a binary, and there can only be one. RLIBs are intermediate artifacts that the Rust compiler creates when compiling library crates. The format is not yet stabilized and can change in the future. The benefit of RLIBs is that they allow arbitrarily mixed Rust and other native libraries. In addition, the build scales better with RLIBs, since each Rust crate is only compiled once and then linked into a binary without further transformations. With static loop and clip, there is an additional bundling step before linking. There is a wrinkle though. The Rust compiler doesn't generate code for all the symbols used in these libraries. For example, code for certain memory allocator functions is generated by the Rust compiler only when producing binary, a static lib, or a clip. This feature is used, for example, by crates that configure the memory allocator for all other dependencies of the binary. If you want to use rlibs in your build graph, you have to explicitly provide definition for these functions. The link on the slide describes one fragile way to do it. Each time the Rust compiler changes some implementation detail and of these functions, you have to update your workaround. Unsurprisingly, there are people working on stabilizing rlibs and on demand generation of allocator functions. And with that, I give this back to Dmitri.
Let's summarize. In a big project, big changes can be only done incrementally. You shouldn't rewrite in Rust just to adopt Rust. You need a much stronger justification. Think about technical, process, and social components of your Rust adoption strategy. Approach Rust adoption as an experiment. Start with a small team, gather data, hold a retrospective, and decide what to do based on your team's and leadership response. Do what is right for your team. It is easier to start using Rust by adding a new binary to the project. If you must use in-process integration, you should aim to provide safe bindings for your non-Rust code. Unfortunately, you might need to redesign some of your APIs to define safe bindings that preserve API expressivity. You need to budget extra time for that. That brings us to the end of the session.
Thank you very much for your time, and we hope this helps you adopt Rust in your project.